speaker, and that's Professor Joanna Haigh. Thank you, Joanna.
Well, thanks, Suzanne. Thanks for the invitation to come here. I think the only way that we're going to get real action on climate change is when it's generally accepted to be happening and important, and when there's just general understanding of the country and indeed across the world, it will be so much easier to get some action. So I'm here to talk about science, which is not going to be physics lecture, you'll be pleased to hear, but perhaps it's to give you some of the information that you might need when you may be confronted by what we might call climate change deniers or something. And while the situation in the UK is not as bad as in the US, where about 50% of the population is still what we might call at least not persuaded by climate change, in the UK there are some, and very well funded and very influential people, particularly in the House of Lords, that still are really climate change deniers. And you need to know, when they say things about it not being the case, or the sort of weasel words, you need to know what's the case and what isn't. So I'm trying to set the scene for you. So you often hear about global warming. What's global warming? Well, it's the temperature change over the surface of the Earth, and it's generally accepted to be the difference in temperature between about 150 years ago and now, which has now gone past the 1 degree mark. So I'll come back to global warming again later. There's a number of other different parameters that you can measure in terms of what is climate change. One, of course, is sea level rise. As the sea gets warmer, it expands and rises. And also, if the ice caps melt, then we get more fresh water. And at the moment, sea level rises about 20 centimetres since pre-industrial, so that's about 1850. And rising. And then there's other measures, for example, the area of sea ice in the Arctic in the summer. So obviously there's an annual cycle, and it's least in summer and most in winter. And you can measure the area of the sea ice in the summer, and it's now about 50% what it was 150 years ago. So these things are all changing. So what we need to know is, we've seen these changes are natural. You can hear people say, oh, climate has always changed, it's all just part of a sort of natural cycle. So we need to analyse quite how we know why these things are happening. Some effects are very much more easy to attribute to climate change than others. So the global temperature rise of 1 degree over 150 years is faster than any other temperature rise in the records going back perhaps hundreds of thousands, billion years. So it's very, very fast. That's very unusual. In addition to which, we actually understand the physics of what's called the greenhouse effect. And we know that carbon dioxide, which is an important greenhouse gas, is rising in the atmosphere. One thing that you might hear is, oh, water vapor is the most important greenhouse gas in the atmosphere, and that's all natural. That's true. Water vapor is the most important greenhouse gas in the atmosphere, but we can't force it to be higher than it wants to be. If you get too much water in the atmosphere, it just rains out again. And when other things cause warming, the water vapor will make things worse because it's a greenhouse gas. You can't force it to be more. What we're forcing to be more is carbon dioxide. And we've got to think about the carbon dioxide concentration now is 400 parts per million, or 4 molecules in every 10,000. Doesn't sound very much, but it's a huge effect. That is higher than the concentration of carbon dioxide for 3 million years, at least, probably more. And these numbers are so big, it's quite difficult to sort of put what's 3 million years. 3 million years ago, there were no primates on Earth. So there hasn't been life on Earth in anything like the carbon dioxide concentrations we've got now. That's a well-established fact. So life is evolving in now a very, very strange environment. Sometimes you hear people say, oh, it's all down to the sun. And of course, if the sun's going to put out more energy, then that tends to warm the climate, it's going to get all our energy from. But we've done studies on that, and we know that the changes in solar energy are, firstly, very small. They can't be responsible for 1 degree. Secondly, at the moment, the sun overall is getting less active, so it can't be causing recent climate change. So I think that's a bit of a non-starter. We've also heard people say in this context, if you look at the ice ages, and you've seen the ice ages, the temperatures going up and down on sort of 100,000-year timescales, and the carbon dioxide is also going up and down on those same sort of timescales, and you've heard people say, see, it's all natural, it's not happening. Or what you're going on about. Actually, that situation is not at all reassuring. is due to changes in the Earth's orbit around the Sun, so that's the solar energy bit, but due to the geometry, not the Sun's activity. So the initial warming is due to the orbit, and then when it starts warming, you get a release of carbon dioxide and indeed other methane and other greenhouse gases from stores, and that escalates the warming. And then when it gets, when the solar bit turns around, everything slowly goes back down again. So far from being reassuring, it's actually rather worrying, because if you've got anything that's going to give it an initial warming kick, then this effect will take place to add on to the effect on a slow timescale. So if that's not reassuring at all. Then of course we need to think about what are the impacts of global warming. Things I've talked about now are sort of rather sort of physical measures of climate change. But when we think about the impacts of global warming, it's more what's happening on a regional basis and things that people really experience. And the first thing to note is that it's not global in the sense that it's not the same everywhere. It's not 1 degree everywhere all over the globe. It's a lot more than that, more than 2 degrees in some of the land areas, and less in some places, particularly over the North Atlantic Ocean, where it's not been warming, it might even be cooling, which is a very interesting problem for the oceanographers and a scientific study ongoing. So that brings us more to the context of weather and climate. What's the difference between weather and climate? So climate is a large area, average sort of behaviour. So you might talk about the climate of southern UK in the summer, sort of thing. Whereas weather is particular what we're experiencing now. So it could be cold and wet, windy this week, and that's weather. And so when you hear people talking about, oh, you can't forecast the weather for more than 10 days, how can you forecast the climate? We're not trying to do the same things, we're trying to do averages, so over larger areas, over typical times, not precisely 10 o'clock on Wednesdays we're talking about. So you may have heard about there's been an increase in extreme weather events in response to climate change, and this is a very much a sort of state-of-the-art scientific investigation that's going on. What we can't say, usually, is that a particular weather event is due to climate change. But what's becoming increasingly clear to understand is that you can attribute certain sorts of climate change to having been more likely to have taken place given climate change. So, for example, that the extreme heat waves that happened in Europe in 2003, which did kill a lot of people, are almost certainly, or much more likely to have been due, or more likely to have happened in the context of global warming. There's been other similar sorts of studies, for example, the extreme rain and flooding in Louisiana in 2016, the likelihood of that happening was much higher because of climate change. So these are studies that are ongoing. It's, as I said, it's very difficult to say, flooding in Oxfordshire is due to climate change, no. But a certain sort of flooding due to extreme rainfall may be more likely to have taken place because of climate change. I'm not watching the time, but So impacts, of course, over the world include, I talked about flooding, river flooding, but also water scarcity and drought in certain regions. In the eastern Mediterranean, there's definite evidence of water scarcity due to climate change. Loss of cropland, which of course affects food production, hugely important for all of us. There's been a huge loss of biodiversity. The ecologists have shown us the numbers of species are actually going down fast. So if we want to predict what's going to happen in the future, we have to not only predict the climate, we have to predict what the CO2 is going to do, which means predicting the economy, which of course is much more difficult and certainly way outside my remit. But we take certain sort of scenarios. Oh, she's still a minute, 3 more minutes. What might happen in the future. If we carry on the current trajectory that we're going, we're aiming at perhaps a 5 degree rise in global temperature by the year 2100. And people often say 5 degree rise, perhaps we're happy with that. But there's several things I'd like to say about that. One, to repeat the fact that it's not 5 degrees, it's not the same local world. It would be extremely, it would be unbearable to live in certain places like in Africa and on the land masses where the temperature rise would be more than 10 degrees. And of course the sea levels would be rising. But the point is that at 2100 you may be at 5 degrees, but it is still rising. That's not the end of the story. And if there's one thing I'd like you to get out of this today from me, It's the need for zero carbon. So you may think, you don't mind 5 degrees, you may even think you don't mind 10 degrees, well that'd be a bit foolish, but you may decide on a temperature threshold that you quite fancy. But if you don't stop emitting carbon dioxide, the temperature will carry on rising, it won't stop. So you've got to bite the bullet and get to zero carbon. And if you want to get to 2 degrees by 2100 and flattening off, we've got to get zero carbon by, say, 2050-ish. That's fine.
Thank you.
I've got a lot more to say.